In 1927, Vincent Youmans saw Showboat, and knowing that that was the kind of American operetta he wanted to write, took confidence from Jerome Kern's success. Youmans was soon after asked to write a score for a libretto by Oscar Hammerstein and Lawrence Stallings, which he understandably saw as an opportunity to write for a more substantial work. The story was far away from the trivial, predominant Cinderella stories of the time. This show was Rainbow, and despite money problems, illnesses, for one, Hammerstein was still recovering from a near nervous breakdown, many problems of presentation during the out-of-town tryouts, and general mismanagement, the show did eventually make the stage. Consequently, though, it suffered badly from comparisons to the fabulously successful Showboat. Remaining, in historians' memories, is one lovely song which was actually cut from Rainbow, Who Am I? Words by Gus Kahn for the Vincent Youmans score for Rainbow. Ellie Quint was the singer. With all of the difficulties that show had suffered, and was still suffering till the bitter end, Rainbow closed after 30 performances. Youmans' previous resolve to produce his own shows was strongly revived. He was determined to handle the whole production himself, and even concocted a story fairly similar to Showboat, which had the working title Louisiana Lou. Its production title was Great Day.
Thank you. That was written for a show called Great Day. And Youmans wrote that show immediately after seeing Showboat. Youmans was a magnificent melodist, but he was not a creator. He was not an originator. He was a copier. His early style, for example, followed Jerome Kern's early style. Later, when Kern did an operetta such as Showboat, he said he could do an operetta such as Showboat. When his friend George Gershwin left the musical theater and decided to write concert music, as you'll read in the book, Vincent Youmans tried to write concert music. He was always aping the others, never really originating any patterns. But Great Day was the show written to copy Showboat. It had a Mississippi River setting, a period setting very much like Showboat's, a large black chorus mixed with a white chorus, which had never been done before Showboat, except for one long-forgotten flop. And right down the line, this was to be his Showboat. And of course it failed, but it's amazing in that this failure, which only ran, I think it was about 5 weeks in New York, left us Great Day, More Than You Know, Without a Song, and Happy Because I'm in Love, four songs you still hear regularly today.
Without a song, the day would never end. Without a song, the road would never bend. When things go wrong, a man ain't got a friend. Without a song, that field of corn would never see a plow. That field of corn would be a desert now. A man is born, but he's no good no how, without a song. I got my trouble and woe, but sure as I know that Jordan will roll, I'll get along as a song is strong in my soul. I'll never know what makes the rain to fall. I'll never know what makes the grass so tall. I only know there ain't no love at all without a song.
Neil Williams singing Without a Song. The show it came from, Great Day, had a rough, under-rehearsed opening in Philadelphia on the 4th of June 1929. Most of the critics found only the score praiseworthy. Panic set in the next day when rewrites and changes, including cast changes, began. Great Day was closed temporarily and with vast changes to everything, eventually opened in New York on the 17th of October 1929, and again only the songs were appreciated by the critics. Stanley Green wrote, "It's doubtful that any other financial failure ever produced as many hit songs." Vincent Youmans had invested, and lost, much of his own money on Great Day. The stock market had recently crashed, and so it was difficult to finance another show when money was so scarce, especially following closely on recent box office disasters. Youmans agreed to write for a Florenz Ziegfeld show. Gerald Boardman picks up the story.
Ziegfeld actually had him thrown out of the theater and banned from entering the theater.
Why? How did that happen?
Oh, it's a very complicated story. He had very few friends. One of the few he did have was his first musical collaborator, Paul Lannan. Now, Paul Lannan was not a great composer. He had written half the music for Two Little Girls and Blue. But he remained thereafter, quite often the orchestrator and even the conductor of Youmans shows. And he had orchestrated and was going to conduct the Ziegfeld production of Smiles, which starred Marilyn Miller and Fred Astaire and Adele Astaire. And by this time, Marilyn Miller was a fading star. She had been a star for 15 years and was towards the end of her career. And the show opened in Boston to dreadful notices. Marilyn Miller, who was Ziegfeld's biggest star, went to him and said, "I want you to get rid of Paul Lannan. I can't stand the tempos that he uses when he conducts. And I also want you to get rid of that dreadful song I have to sing in the show. It's awful." Well, Ziegfeld called Youmans in, and Youmans pointed out he had a contract that he had the right to appoint the musical conductor, and that Lannan was his close friend, and that if Lannan were fired, Youmans would take all his orchestrations and quit the show. And indeed, Ziegfeld realized that he meant business. So he had some people watching, and when Youmans and Lannan did in fact come to pull out all the orchestrations, Ziegfeld had him strong-armed out of the theater and got an injunction. Now, a compromise was worked out. The orchestrations were kept. Another conductor was gotten. But the song that Marilyn Miller refused to sing was changed in that Ring Lardner, the great American humorist, was called in to give it new lyrics for her. I forget what the name of the song was with the new lyrics. But the original version was also kept in the show, sung by Paul Gregory, as Time on My Hands.
When the day fades away into twilight, the moon is my light of love. In the night I am quite a romancer. I find an unsolvable.
Eddie Grummet singing one of Vincent Youmans' loveliest ballads, with lyrics by Harold Adamson and Mac Gordon, Time on My Hands. An interesting sidelight to that show, Smiles. Bob Hope was one of the dancing boys. In 1930, Youmans, like so many other composers of the time, went to Hollywood. The musical theatre in New York was suffering badly from the effects of the Depression, but the movie kingdom out west seemed to have endless resources. The first film of his, Hit the Deck, had been released 3 years earlier, and films of No No Nanette and Rainbow, now called Song of the West, had already been made. He was now to write for a Gloria Swanson movie, What a Widow. The songs, with words by Edward Eliscu, were unexceptional, so was the picture, but I rather like this number. Love is like a song. Love is like a song, sung by Ellie Quint. Like so many events in his life, Youmans' timing was out for a Hollywood career. The producers felt they'd given the public too many musicals in the previous few years, and so were cooling off on the idea of song and dance. So Youmans returned to New York. At a dinner party there in 1931, he met Jane Carl, who'd had great success in a 1919 tearjerker, Smile and Through, to which she held the rights. They met later to discuss the possibility of making it a musical. That agreed, and Brian Hooker was employed to write the libretto. A surprising decision, really, as his only major success had been The Vagabond King. Al Dubin was to write the lyrics, but backed off, and a young lyricist by the name of Edward Heyman was brought in. Still called Smiling Through, it had its first public hearing on the 28th of December 1931 in Philadelphia. The critics were divided on the musical's worth. Rewrites, cast changes, and the show opened in Washington, D.C., now entitled Love is All. On the 28th of January 1932, it opened in New York. It was now called Through the Years, the title taken from one of the songs which Youmans was really excited about.
No matter when or where. mine I'll always share. Through the night I'll be a star to guide you, shining bright, though clouds may come and hide you. Time first disappears. I'll come to you, smiling through the
Nolan Van Way through the years, which remained Vincent Youmans' own favourite. In New York, the show was seen by the critics as an operetta. Terry Hughes again talking with Gerald Boardman.
We talked earlier about his style, that he sometimes aped people that he admired, and right. There seems to be a criticism through a lot of your book that he was slipping back into operetta in a period when it was becoming unfashionable.
Yeah, he was there just at the wrong time. Because it's true that Showboat pointed the way to the future American operetta. But nothing followed Showboat immediately. Nothing followed it for 15 years. And you came almost immediately after Showboat into the Depression. And the liberals, the left wing, took over this country. And what they wanted were songs with social significance. So that Vincent Youmans' whole school of writing, whether it was those light, frothy, hedonistic musical comedies, or even the operettas that he was drifting towards. That whole school of musical comedy suddenly seemed to be retrogressive, to be very characteristic of the conservative thinking that the liberals and the left despised, with the result that Youmans' shows were sneered at. And it wasn't until the 70s when we began to reconsider that we could look at No, No, Nanette again. Operetta came in just before he died. We don't call it operetta today. We call it musical play. But Oklahoma and South Pacific and The King and I are pure operetta as opposed to musical comedy. Youmans sensed this. In one of the last interviews he gave, he said that Oklahoma will lead, is the start of something great and will lead the American musical theater into a new era of greatness. And he sensed that immediately. He picked it up. And he was, of course, quite right. No, operetta generally is set in bygone times and generally set in a faraway place, a romantically faraway place, such as Siam or a South Sea Island or even just the wild, wild romantic West, not the real Wild West, which was smelly and rough. It tends to have the leading singers sing more arioso songs. Musical comedy songs are based on recitative. You can talk T for Two or I Want to Be Happy with the music behind you. It's going to sound very awful if you try to talk Ah, Sweet Mystery of Life or Some Enchanted Evening. So the great Rodgers and Hammerstein works are all pure operetta. But because the liberals had decided that operetta was old-fashioned and outdated, they couldn't call it that. They gave it a new term, though I would suggest you go back and you'll discover, for example, that Rosemarie, one of the quintessential operettas of the 1920s, was called a musical play.
He recognized Oklahoma as being yes. one of the first definite changes, but I think that show has been given a bit too much credit for being one of the first integrated musicals and all that. It really wasn't it?
No, of course not. They've been integrating words and music beautifully since Gilbert and Sullivan, who started it all anyway, essentially. The most you can say about Oklahoma in that respect is that it brought the dance more closely in with the story. But even there, On Your Toes, which they're reviving this year here now, the great ballet of On Your Toes, Slaughter on 10th Avenue relates to the plot of the show, to the rest of the story.
And that's, that's much older than we think. Yes. I remember at MGM, and probably most listeners did, but when was that written?
1936. So what you have is Oklahoma doing really nothing new, but it did everything so well, and we were so desperate for something at that point. It was the right show at the right time, and whereas Showboat was the right show at the wrong time. It was a hit, but for a number of reasons, nobody really followed up. Now, with Oklahoma, they all followed, and we went into this era of American operetta or musical play, where the operettas were set, had American settings quite often. They never had before.
Oklahoma opens, of course, with Oh, What a Beautiful Morning, and everyone said it's the first time a show's opened with a lovely ballad just done a cappella. But he wrote a show that started very similarly a long time before then.
Yes, through the years. Now, it wasn't supposed to start that way, as I recall. He had another song that they dropped, and so they had a very soft, lovely Irish song opening the show.
Through the Years was very important, I might say, in a rather sad way to Youmans. He was in a very difficult period then, wasn't he?
Yes. Through the Years was the last show that he really put his stamp on. Afterwards, he interpolated some songs, great ones, mind you, such as Rise and Shine, into Take a Chance, and then wrote the first Fred Astaire Ginger Rogers film, Flying Down to Rio. But Through the Years was his last major effort on Broadway, and left us songs such as Through the Years, which is his own favorite song, and Drums in My Heart. I think only ran about 4 or 5 weeks.
This was
total flop.
Terrible reviews, but there's some lovely music in it.
Oh, there's great music in it, just as there was great music in Great Day.
Do you think we didn't understand, the critics, or the audience didn't understand what he was trying to do?
It may be a combination of things. It may be simply that the books were bad. I certainly suspect that of Great Day, which got so complicated during the tryout. I know Eddie Heyman didn't think the book was bad. It might even been workable 5 years before, but by that time the feelings against operetta had all set in, and it was looked on as just too old-fashioned. Because when you think of the great music these shows had, they should have been able to carry it. Go back and realize how many ludicrous plots lesser music carried. And it's just very, very sad that so much of his best material was for flop shows, and very little of it was for hits.
I ask you, why are you treating me so? I'd like to know. Where is the kiss I should get? I ask you, what would a Romeo do? Show me, oh do. Let me be your Juliet. From my balcony, a little love scene we can play. But we'll have to make the ending gay. Kinda hate rain, kinda hate clouds, kinda like you I do. Kinda hate noise, kinda hate crowds, kinda like you I do. Sorta feel grand holding your hand, this is a brand new feeling. Sorta feel nice kissing you twice, it's paradise. Kinda hate tears, kinda hate sighs, kinda like you I do. Kinda hate jokes, kinda hate lies, kinda like you I do. Deed I do. Where is that boy who will need me? Someone I'd stick right to. All along I hope that he'd be kinda like you.
like you I do. Indeed I do. Where is that boy who will need me? Someone I'd stick right to. All along I hope that he'd be kinda like you. All along I hope that he'd be kinda like you.
Kinda Like You from Through the Years, Vincent Youmans' favourite of his own shows. The song sung then by Millie Slaven. Through the years of failure, Vincent Youmans was hardly poor, but he had an expensive lifestyle, and so when asked to write for other producers, he accepted. The next show Youmans had anything to do with was a vehicle for a bright new young lady, Ethel Merman. The score was by Lawrence Schwab and Buddy De Silva, and while they hadn't done well out of town, their attitude gave the show its title, Take a Chance. They decided to do just that and asked Vincent Youmans to write some extra material.
This is all I know, dear. I want to be with you. Where'er you go, dear. If I can be with you, all care is ended for me. I am even willing to sit and look at you, because you're thrilling. Just let me look at you, and how contented I'll be. In the years to come, I'll continue to try to win you the same as now. For I love your nearness. I want to be with you in all your dearness. If I can be with you, life's just beginning for me. When we met, a chill went through me, stood there like a dunce. Never felt so silly or so grand.
Guess this thing that's happened to me only happens once. Once is all that anyone could stand.
In the years to come, I'll continue to try to win you the same as now. Oh, I love your nearness. I want to be with you in all your dearness. If I can be with you, life's just beginning. And old depression takes you in tow.
Life is loving, laughing, and say what of it?
No dream of quitting when trouble starts and hitting you low.
Stick your chin up, make your mind up, and you win up.
The Navy gave you a motto that can save you, I know. So, rise and shine. Stand up and take it. Rise and shine. Like what you make it. If Bloom the so-and-so should get you, as he soon does, shout hidey, hidey, ho, and do just as the moon does. Rise and shine.
Rise and shine.
Don't be a mourner.
Cheer up.
Things are fine.
Things are fine.
Around the corner. No harm in trying it. There's nothing to it. You can do it like the sun. Rise and shine.
Rise and shine.
the show Take a Chance did in New York, opening on the 26th of November 1932. And it had a most respectable run for the times of 243 performances. In 1933, the big success of 42nd Street convinced Hollywood that film musicals might again be moneymakers. Vincent Youmans had several offers, but finally accepted one from RKO to write for Flying Down to Rio, starring Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers.
Well, I think I ought to say something about this next one, the Carioca. It was the big tune from Flying Down to Rio, my first important picture with that wonderful gal, Ginger Rogers. And it really started that series of Ginger Rogers, Fred Astaire pictures.
Have you seen the Carioca? It's not a foxtrot or a polka. It has a little bit of new rhythm, a blue rhythm that sighs. It has a meter that is tricky, a bit of wicked, wacky, wicky. But when you dance it with a new love, there'll be true love in her eyes. You'll dream of the new Carioca. Its theme is a kiss and a sigh. You'll dream of the new Carioca. When music and lights are gone and we're saying goodbye. Two heads together, they say, are better than one. Two heads together, that's how the dance has begun. Two arms around you, and lips that sigh. I am yours and you are mine, while the Carioca carries you away. Mine, while we Carioca till the break of day. And you are mine.
Anything wrong to you?
No. Oh, no. It was so warm in there.
Romantic music, isn't it?
Isn't it?
The words are romantic, too, and dangerous. For instance, in the moonlight, on a tropical island, they might make any woman fall in love with any man.
Orchids bloom in the moonlight, and lovers vow to be true. I still can dream in the moonlight of one dear night that we knew. When orchids fade in the dawning, they speak of tears and goodbye. So my dreams are shattered, like the petals scattered, still my love can never die. There is rest in the twilight, when the day is new, but the shadows that fall only seem to recall all my longing for you. There's a dream when the moon beams upon a sea of blue, but the moonbeams that fall only seem seem to recall. Love is all, love is you.
Probably one of the first musical scores that interpolated Latin American rhythms.
Oh, it started the craze for Latin American rhythms in this country, especially the samba, which is what the carioca is essentially. And, of course, the tango had been around for quite a while. But those modern, lighter dances, the craze really began about that time. It goes back a little earlier, Siboney, but that wasn't in a show. But I think this really, more than anything else, initiated the craze for Latin music, which he retained until the end because, you know, his last show was a show he produced but didn't write any music for. And the music for the show was written by Ernesto Lecuona.
It was called
The Vincent Youmans Review.
One of the very well-known Latin American music writers. The carioca in that film goes on and on, and of course that was a failing of all Busby Berkeley movies. He just dragged and dragged and dragged and played it to death. But it holds up. It just flows through the whole film.
But I suspect, you know, he gave the public what it wanted at the time. I think we've lost patience. Even today, you can't have the show last as long as the show lasted years ago. We used to go, when I was very young, into the theater. The curtain would go up at 8:30. And would come down sometime between 11 and 11:30. Today, if you go in, the show curtain rises maybe at 9:15, and I think by 10 o'clock you're out of the theater. We don't have the patience to sit through the shows. You know, Showboat originally ran 5 hours. Nobody would dare do it that way anymore.
At the beginning of this program, I mentioned that Gerald Boardman, author of the Vincent Youmans biography, called his book Days to be Happy, Years to be Sad. That title sums up Youmans' life fairly well. After all the years of heavy drinking and hard living, he suffered the consequences. TB developed to wreck his body. His desire to write more important concert pieces left behind his real abilities, writing wonderful, clever melodies. In New York, he once met Sergei Rachmaninoff, who revealed his enthusiasm for Youmans music. Vincent Youmans told Rachmaninoff that he wanted to write extended works. The Russian suggested that he concentrate on form and orchestration, and the two finally settled on mutual help. Rachmaninoff would give Youmans lessons if Youmans would teach him how to play in the popular style. Like most of the projects during the rest of Youmans' life, nothing ever came of it.
He died in 46, and for a long time he was almost totally forgotten. Even people interested in music and people writing over the years said, well, Vincent Youmans, so what? And you probably got some of that reaction when you approached Oxford Press about writing a book about him.
Unfortunately, I did. There was a bit of irony there in that my editor and I chose a subject. We were both happy with it. And then after my editor presented it to the board said no. And so I went to other publishers, and my editor got wind of this and called me and said, please don't, we'll do the book. And I said, the only problem with that is you won't have your heart behind it, and I don't think you'll promote it. He says, believe me, once we do a book, we promote it. So I agreed, and Oxford agreed, and we did the book, and they haven't promoted it. But I'm sure that the people who care about Vincent Youmans and the great old musicals have a way of finding out that this sort of thing is on the market and picking it up.
Is it possible, and I know you don't like doing this, but is it possible to sum up the man? His work wasn't such a great range of work, was it?
Well, it's a surprising range. His early songs are fascinating in that they're the most identifiable of any composer's. He would take a two or three or four note tightly composed theme, four notes virtually touching each other, and he would play that over varying harmonics, or perhaps just changing the tempo a bit, and go over and over that. Dum da 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 dum. His early songs have very, very tiny ranges. Then, after he saw Kern expanding the musical line, Youmans went and expanded his own musical line, and you get the songs such as Through the Years or The Music in Great Day, which tend to have more curvaceous, longer-lined melodies. None of his serious work survived, the stuff he was doing in competition with Gershwin, so we don't know what it really sounded like. There are some interesting descriptions in the book of a variation played backwards, for example. But then, of course, at the very end, he recognized what he did best of all, which was that light, essentially dance-based tune, and he went back to it with the marvelous music for the Astaire Rogers film.
Yes, it would have been nice mm-hmm. if he'd had that mm-hmm. confidence all through
right.
his career.
Right.
That simple song, I Want to Be Happy.
Right.
Dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun.
Well, it's pathetic when you read the story after flying down to Rio, because Hollywood kept coming to him, kept making him fabulous offers. He had all sorts of offers from Broadway. But he just no longer cared. Privately, he told friends he was afraid that anything he wrote would be grabbed by the courts and the monies given to his first wife and children. And for that reason, he said he wasn't going to write anything. Whether that was the real reason or not, I don't know.
What was the reaction when he died in 46? Did people say, well, you know, we knew it was going to happen, or was there genuine sadness?
Well, I think there was a great deal of genuine sadness. It was a different era. We were more traditional then. We remembered. So that Vincent Youmans, even though he hadn't produced anything in 13 years, was still a remembered and revered name. He mentions in his letters in the late 30s, for example, just walking into hotels and signing his name to a register got him a very special welcome. I don't think that Charlie Strauss today, or Jerry Bach, or even Stephen Sondheim could do that. We don't recognize our theater people or care about them the way we used to.
He died of a combination of what, tuberculosis and alcoholism.
Yes, right. He died of tuberculosis. His doctors, by the way, though they're in their 80s, are still alive. And it's interesting how they share the same memories, that he had one of the mildest cases they had ever seen, and that if he had simply taken care of himself, he probably could have cured it. But as you read in the book, he'd rest somewhere a week and say that's enough and go on a binge. And there's no question, I think, though he didn't realize it himself, he was trying to kill himself.
And he died in 46, which is, I should imagine, fairly close to a cure for TB.
His daughter now, who is a very famous New York City doctor, said the cure came out just months after he died. By that time, of course, it probably would have been too late to help him. Even if he had lived, he would have probably been in too advanced a state.
Vincent Youmans' first song was published in 1920. His last works for Flying Down to Rio in 1933. All of his music was in that 13-year period. Another 13 years, and he was dead. Late in his life, he was studying in New Orleans, studying with Professor Ferdinand Dunkley at the Loyola School of Music. One night, a concert of Vincent Youmans' songs was organized with the band in the Blue Room of the Roosevelt Hotel. With wide publicity, the place was crowded, and the audience loved it. Vincent Youmans, by then a thin little man, sat in a corner. His only reaction, an occasional smile at what he heard, but he refused to be introduced to the audience. He stayed off in the shadows and just listened. To acknowledge the help of Gerald Boardman in preparing this tribute to Vincent Youmans. Terry Hughes of our New York office was the interviewer. Kenny Powell played the solo piano pieces. Michael Ingemels was the studio producer, and Graham Milne, the technical producer. Script and presentation by Jim McLeod.